Yeah, so I was looking on YouTube, and I think I know why this video is my most viewed video, because I think it's literally the only one I could find on the Spellmonger series. To that end, I'm embarking on an attempt to try and review all the books. It might not go well, and it might not be all the way through, but hey, you never know until you start. So yeah, this is a review of the first Spellmonger book, keeping in mind that I already said I love the series. One of the first things that I noticed when I was reading through this book a second time was, well, actually, I was listening to it. I read it once, but then I just listened to it on audiobook. But the way the author gives out information is very, well, it works well with this. It also works to set the scene in several ways. The very first introduction we get to this is the main character, Min, being woken up in the middle of the night with an emergency bell ringing. And to tell you the character's name, the author says that the author gets us into the headspace of the character, saying that the bell feels like it's ringing out my name. Min, 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 Min. And I just thought that was a really good way of getting, like, some trivial information across. That stuck out to me, but that continues throughout the book. We'll get trivial amounts of information sprinkled in through set dressing in the series. And I really enjoyed that aspect because it made it feel less like you're reading a textbook. To that end, I also have to say that I find that the action scenes, if anyone doesn't know this, I'm not hugely into action scenes in books. I can kind of take them or leave them. I mostly skim them. Do a pretty good job of focusing on, like, I would say the vivid horror of the situation. I've never been in sort of a combat role or anything, but we've all felt like an adrenaline rush at certain times, and you'll always find that there'll be like weird things that you'll just like hyper focus on in like the way that something falls down, sort of looks like something you recognize, and you get hyper focused on that for just a few seconds, and it really helps sell the sort of vivid horror of the situation of the given situation. So, now on to chapter two. The book does something that might be someone that, I don't know, you might like or you might dislike. It intersects chapters with what's going on in the main story by just throwing us back in time and giving us a basic summary of the character's life up until then. So it kind of shifts back and forth between past and present. The narration style is what you might call first person passive. I can't remember. It's from the first person using pronouns like this already happened. Like we were there, and then we went there, and then after that. And there was just one point where it wasn't quite the right tense, I guess you'd say. But that doesn't happen frequently. I think it was one time, and that might have just been me not paying attention, or maybe it was the person reading. Like I said, I re-listened to this on audio, but some people I know don't really like the first person perspective on things. But a few other things I noticed while I was reading through this book is I really like that in this series as a whole, but in this book in particular, basically being a dick isn't a class thing. The lord of the land that the character finds himself in is basically, he's a pretty decent dude originally, and his Casterlands, Sire K, is also a pretty decent dude. And there's a lot of this sort of, in a lot of media like this, authors seem to be tempted to try and make all people of this class, of particularly the upper class, massive a-holes. And don't get me wrong, a lot of them are. But a lot of them are people who are just trying to do their best and are pretty decent people. And I appreciate that didn't just make sort of a class divide in this sort of thing. All commoners are noble, hardworking individuals. Some are rat bastards. And all nobles are corrupt hypocrites. Some are, pretty decent dudes who you should probably listen to. And again, this makes the world feel just a bit more real to me. If you can't tell, I'm going for a sort of vague interpretation. I'm not trying to say anything specific. A subtle bit of foreshadowing that I didn't notice beforehand, but I do now that I've read all the series. When we're first getting like the lay of the land, there are basically three mages in this barony. I don't know exactly what it is, but in this part of the kingdom, right? And basically the most hacky version is a guy named Gokescu. Throws up a lot of like arcane crap to impress people who don't know any better.
You can't use it. It takes years of training and experience and hey, you know, I'm trying to make this magic stuff look hard.
And then our protagonist admits that he does do some of that. It's not nearly as gaudy as the hack in the next village over. But then there's another guy who is completely unpretentious about all this sort of thing. He just does this stuff because he does this stuff, and you can take it or you can leave it. And there's a subtle implication about this that guy probably has the least to hide and the least to be worried about anyone finding out that he's not exactly how he presents himself. And, you know, it's a sliding scale on that. The hack dude does it the most. The intermediate guy just sort of does it, but not much. And the guy who doesn't do it at all is completely unpretentious about it. He doesn't, like, ornament his house with, like, skulls and alcohol or something to impress peasants and shit. The foreshadowing I didn't see is, in the next chapter, we go meet the elf analog in this series called the Alcalon, although I do think they are sometimes just called elves. They live in a wonderful magical kingdom and are completely above all the petty politics of humanity and yada yada. You can see where I'm going with this.
Hey, you know who lives in this house? A great big phony!
That's a nice bit of foreshadowing in the first book that I didn't notice until now. That's kind of a spoiler, but eh. But yeah, the latter half of this first book is basically a siege story, and as I mentioned in my initial video on the subject, I like that the problem that they are overcoming is overcome in simple, clever ways. I've often said this feels like the most real use of magic, because people are using magic in the way that I would expect the human race to do it. It's not about having raw power, it's about the application of that power. But yeah, the latter half of this is basically just a siege story. They're in a siege, holding out as long as they can, until they can either evacuate or help comes. Suffice to say, it's bittersweet enough, while also not coming across as insanely depressing. Again, cynicism doesn't mean that you're smart. But as to that, how's the characterization in this book? Pretty good. The main character is sympathetic and likable while still obviously having his own issues and flaws that he needs to overcome. Dude's kind of a horny bastard. The apprentice character in this series mostly exists as a springboard to explain magical concepts to for this first book, Tyndall. He doesn't really gain a personality much beyond that. It becomes expanded upon in later books, but just for this book, he doesn't feel like he has much of a personality. I've already mentioned that I liked that the Lord characters weren't just 100% a-hole pricks. You know, there was some nuance to their depiction, even though in the end they didn't end up looking that great. Alia was amusing and such, and I liked her, but again, not a lot expanded upon in this first book. It's a setup for a greater story, and that is an issue with this first book. It is a setup for a very large story, so you can't get to know everyone as well as you end up, you know, actually doing in the end. I would say the second most important character in this book ends up being the character Pentandra, who is basically Min's ex-girlfriend, and it comes back up. Let's just say the climax to this book means climax in more ways than one. But I liked her frank and honest discussion about sorts of things, and how she tends to be the person to break down stuff Barney style to our main character and the audience about the relationships of power and, you know, sex and that sort of thing. You see a few other characters that, again, get later expanded upon, but if you're looking at the series and feeling like some of the characters feel somewhat flat in this first book, I would say read on, because they do get better. it's 11 books. It'd be pretty hard for them not to get more rounded. So yeah, that's my review of the first Spellmonger book. Is it my favorite fantasy book ever written? No, but it is a good start to this series, and I can say that reading the first book really made me want to read the second book. Not all series can do that. So on a scale of 1 to 2, it's a 2. Yeah, my scaling system basically boils down to the Roman Empire system.
Are you not entertained?